comme une fille, la rue se déshabille, les pavés s'entassent et les flics qui passent les prennent sur la gueule. Paris, Marseille, les rues sont pareilles, quand le sang y coule, la mort y roucoule, une rose dans la gueule. Comme une fille qui a les yeux qui brillent et met ses grenades sur la barricade, la rue a ses charmes et les flics en armes les prennent dans la tronche. Paris ou Nantes, les rues sont patientes jusqu'à la nuit blême des pavés qu'on sème, quand le sang y gerce et que la mort y berce le passant qui bronche.
Hello, I'm Chris Reynolds. As our interviews came to a close with these scholars who had experienced May 68, we asked each interviewee to attempt a 30-second summary of their experiences of 1968. Some were better at keeping the time than others. The results were nevertheless very rich.
Really a total surprise to me, and it did disrupt my life for a while in a pretty significant way, as I've described it. And it is perhaps the single strongest impression I hold from my period as a student. And I would later draw on that experience and have drawn on that experience for understanding a revolution and particularly the role of emotions, the psychology, the mentalité of a revolution. Yeah, so it was a big deal, especially in retrospect for me personally.
Very exciting, very stimulating, very revealing, big crystallizing impact on ideas that were probably a little bit untidy and disorganized, enjoyable, quite a privilege to have been there, I suppose, not traumatic personally in any way, which was good.
A challenging moment for a city. The expression of a dream, the partial realization of hopes, and in a way, a challenge for the next generation.
I think I would say, what could be better than having the graffiti be the surrealist poets' verses of surrealist poetry covering the wall of the city of Paris? What more could you ask for?
I'd say it was an exciting time when the world seemed to be changing. It didn't change as much as we thought it was, and we didn't necessarily know what was going on, but we knew something was going on, and it really provided a spark for a lot of things that came after it in France and probably more widely as well. I think the French model was looked at very, very widely, and I think informed a lot of what happened over the next couple of decades in the rest of Western Europe.
I would say that the events demonstrated the fragility, the unexpected fragility of the French government structure as created by de Gaulle, which had seemed perfectly stable up to that point. And I think no one even had a hint of this coming. I think that's the main, and I would say the second would be the volatility of the political volatility of the universities, which had not been detected hitherto either. And perhaps third would be my personal sense of how easy it is for the things we take for granted in society, how easily for them to slip away point by point until you wonder, you know, what kind of country you're living in.
Donc, il fallait que ça change pour des raisons de pyramide des âges, pour des raisons d'éloignement de la Deuxième Guerre mondiale qui parlait aux uns et pas aux autres, et pour des raisons tout simplement que le rattrapage économique était fini, on était revenu à la normale, on n'était plus en train de courir après d'abord l'alimentation, puis le logement, puis autre chose. Bon, on était dans un état intermédiaire entre la France, entre l'Allemagne et l'Angleterre. L'Angleterre un peu détruite, pas trop. L'Allemagne complètement détruite, on était dans un état intermédiaire. Donc pendant un certain temps, ce qui explique en partie les Trente Glorieuses, on a travaillé comme des fous, reconstruit, aller voir des Américains, aller voir des Japonais, comment ils faisaient, enfin on a travaillé.
Dickens would say it was the best of times, it was the worst of times. I think that as an American student, there was a part of it that it was this great experience that I was privileged to have, and privileged is an odd word, but I think that's what I felt, that I was part of what certainly seemed at the time like a social, a moment of social upheaval that I was very glad to have experienced, that gave me a very different perspective on France.
I would say that I was an observer. In May 68, I was an observer in the provinces in a city where not a lot happened, where some interesting things did happen, like the big demonstration of right-wingers in De Gaulle's, which is against the bastard era of May 68, which sees the demonstrations as overwhelmingly left-wing and socialist in its aspirations, social democratic in its aspirations. The right-wing nature of the city then in those days was much more prominent than it is now. So I was a witness and observer in a place that has a different history.
I think that I have lived there a marvelous experience of France, of first, but much more still of how people can get together towards something that goes beyond their imagination. That's
fact. It would be exhilaration, terror, and a sense really of potentiality.
Les conséquences sur les jeunes générations, à la fois des Trente Glorieuses, la France était reconstruite, elle était riche, la société de consommation avait pris forme, la société marchande avec tous ces défauts que l'on commençait d'entrevoir. La guerre d'Algérie, telle qu'elle avait été conduite et avait mené, avait conduit un certain nombre de jeunes à critiquer les appareils politiques qui les avaient mis dans des situations, qui avaient créé des situations impossibles et qui en fait avaient été conduits à l'échec. Et face à l'université, quand on s'est retrouvé devant l'université, c'était un monobloc qui ne trouvait pas les chemins de sa démocratisation. Les différentes critiques se sont focalisées sur l'université jusqu'à provoquer la crise universitaire qui reste pour moi l'essentiel de mai 68.
The realization that society is actually not a thing. It's a process. It's not stable. It's stable. If it has the appearance of stability, that's because we keep doing the same thing every day. And if we stopped obeying, it would disintegrate. We could remake it in some entirely different way using the resources that we inherit from the past. And that was the realization that came to me in 68, and it's been with me ever since.
I'd say predictable chaos, because there was so much which had been boiling for a long time in terms of certainly what was happening in universities. Predictable chaos, and then semi-managed chaos afterwards, and certainly a form of hypocrisy in the intellectual life in France, definitely. Yeah, long-lasting hypocrisy.
Okay, generosity. And 32nd, it has been a time of generosity among students and workers. And this generosity s'est fracassée contre le mur d'argent. But it has been a time of real generosity. Open generosity, yes.
Well, I have to come back to the two words, exhilarating and friendly. Exhilarating because, you know, it's a Wordsworthian moment. Bliss was it in that dawn to be alive. But at the same time, where is it all leading? And are we in danger or not? So those are the two aspects. And I certainly feel enriched for having experienced it
an educational revolution that did not fully succeed.
It was exciting. It was incredibly vivid. You know, it's it was very brightly coloured. It affected me to the extent that, you know, I still think about it. I wrote a novel about it on Kindle. It stayed with me. It's not a thing I would care to go through again, but I'm very glad I did go through it.
It was extremely inspirational, and it convinced me that it was possible for the mass of ordinary people to change society for the better, to make a revolution and to make a better world.
It gave me a perspective on cultural and political change that, and the possibility of it, that has been with me all my life. And then, of course, it was the most fascinating and engaging period of my life. It's not to say that other things haven't been just as in a different way, but that was a good one, and I'm deeply grateful for it. So that's 30 seconds.